said good day, sir!
Welcome everybody here back to your coverage of the Defense Season 4. EIZO has put forward $25,000 up for grabs for all the teams which are competing. And of course, we have got the best teams from both Europe as well as the US to compete in this tournament, going through a group stage where there's four groups. The number one team from the group stage will go through into the upper bracket of the playoff, where the second and third position will go into the lower part of the playoff. Of course, that does make some risk for two of the teams. There's five teams per group, and at this point, if you look at the standings, Na'Vi and Team Empire in 4th and 5th position of these groups. Of course, Na'Vi only playing one game, same as Team Empire, but Na'Vi about to play two out of their four games tonight, one after the other. Their first game is right now up against Keita Gaming, and Keita Gaming, the guys, who managed to actually take a 2-0 win over RoX.KIS, a game which no one was really expecting to actually have happened that way, but it happened nonetheless. They've been playing some really good Dota, and they're going to be playing it up against Na'Vi right now. Of course, the managers are going to be joining me to explain the good Dota and the intricate details of it is my co-commentator Clairvoyance. Welcome back to the broadcast, man.
Oh, thanks for having me. There's during the break, there was actually a lot of things that just came up. I was actually just talking to one of my boys down in China, and there's some IG drama going on that's really, really interesting. I guess that's not really, this is not really the time for that though. But the interesting thing here is Keita Gaming. Correct me if I'm wrong on this, but they're the clear favorites here are Na'Vi.
I'm not gonna say clear favorites. I'm gonna say favorites, yes, but I'm not gonna say clear favorites. Not in my mind. Keita Gaming has been playing some really good coordinated games there. Their structure of their draft's been really nicely done. Their execution has also been very good. I really don't see Na'Vi having an easy time in this game. I really do not.
Right, right. That's certainly possible with the draft that's coming up. And the reason I asked that is because I wanted to follow up with some comments that I know of Keita Gaming. I've seen that CYSO guy, CYSO guy, playing in games before. But more importantly, this Maglev Gang Training guy, him and I used to flame each other in pubs. So I have a relationship with this guy. He used to trash talk me and I trash talked him. It was really, really funny. Now, I gotta say, honestly, to see him in the big stage, I'm very impressed because I knew when I first saw this guy, and you know, normally when you choose a target to trash talk and stuff like that with those kind of egoistic banters towards each other in pub games, you do it because you see something in the other. You don't just acknowledge the other by talking to them when you don't care about who they are, don't care about their life, and don't acknowledge their skill. I acknowledge this guy's skill. He's a really talented individual when I saw him individually. And I know this might be a little bit unrelated, but he was rated like top 10 on the Dota buff charts too when it came out. So no doubt in my mind that this guy is definitely a pop star making it big. If he puts out the performance that I expect him to, I have no doubts in my mind they can even take out Na'Vi. And speaking of Na'Vi, they picked up the Lifestealer, Visage, and Darkseer. Very standard-esque with regards to Na'Vi drafts. You know, we have the Darkseer on the Funic. We have the Lifestealer on probably Na'Vi Havost, who is in lower caps right now. But the Visage pick has been coming out consistently out of them. And this is basically what I see as Kuroki's new Rubik.
Yeah, it almost is, isn't it?
Yeah. Yeah, he's been playing it every other game. And you know, the thing is, you mentioned it the other day when we were talking about the hero as a general. You said, like, yeah, how fluff and stuff, try to bring in the competitive stuff. The Chinese really made a clear tell of it by picking it, like, every single game in the G League and the qualifiers and all that stuff.
It caused me to actually lose my compendium bet. I said SD, damn it, and Visage. It's just like, damn it to hell. But yeah.
Yeah.
Most picked hero in the Eastern qualifiers.
Yeah, and to me, I'm going to be honest, it's really no surprise for me. Like, I think, like, if the game lasts in a similar state of metagame to TI3, Visage as well as Shadow Demon, along with Chen, are going to be top picks. And the thing with heroes like Visage and Chen are, in the right hands, they're always going to be a lot more powerful, simply because they just do a lot more, you know what I mean? You work with stuff like Shadow Demon Illusions. You work with stuff like things that give vision. You work with stuff like microing creeps to landing crucial stuns that could change the game. If you have the option available for you, whether you're great at it or not, if you just put out that option, you exercise its mechanic to the full potential in one instance, you're going to change the game. And for a game-changing player like Kuroki, because Hobi, let's be honest, this guy, he makes the plays out of this world a lot of times.
Uh-huh.
With a hero like Visage, with heroes like Rubick, it's definitely a role that would suit him.
Well, we are going to see him play it tonight. At least we should. We should. There are still more options to go as we go through our next part of the draft. So, Keita Gaming, we've got SD, Clockwork, Lina. Just those three heroes together almost make up a tri-lane. Aggressive one as well, if they want to give that one a shot. But they have a lot of flexibility in the lanes, even Clockwork for the mid. As far as the last bans now coming off from Puppy, he's mainly focused on the heroes who will combine up nicely for an aggressive tri-lane with the Juggernaut. Now finding his way into the ban, so it could have been Jugga, SD, and Lina together. Another brutal combo. And he just takes out the PL, maybe because they feel they don't want to go up against him. They don't have any kind of cleave. Realizing, too, that Magnus has gone completely unnoticed through this first set. Last ban going to be Alchemist, so it does look like Na'Vi want to go into this kind of, let's just farm ourselves up. If they are going to run an aggressive tri-lane, I doubt it. With the Alchemist and the PL being banned out, I got a feeling where Na'Vi just wants to go safe, secure. Let's just go with what's the normal for them right now.
Right, right. And it's pretty indicative of that, especially with the picks, but more also with the picks. I mean, the bans are great, but with Clockwork and Shadow Demon in the fray, I mean, most of the time when you give up Shadow Demon early, you kind of don't want to go aggressive against that because Shadow Demon's defensive capabilities as well as his optional offensive are incredible, which is why he's one of the top picks. With Visage as well as Lifestealer, it's definitely an option. However, is it a risk they want to take? With the bans, as you say, it doesn't seem like it's the risk, but they still do have two picks. It's up their sleeves. It could be potential surprises. But one note is for sure is that Magnus generally gets hard countered by a Clockwork. And with the Lifestealer, I feel like they want to synergize with heroes like Puck and Storm, which are unfortunately banned.
Mm-hmm.
In my head, Queen is the way to go here for Denny.
Yeah, I'd agree. It's one of the last jumper heroes that also does some nice burst damage. And up against the SD and the Lina, depending on the initiation timing, it could be enough just to pop him instantly.
Mm-hmm.
But as if Puppy also wants to pick that one up just yet, because Keita Gaming, they also don't have a mid-solo yet. We don't know what he'll be up against in the middle lane.
Could it be Kunkka?
Kunkka could be an option, yeah. But that's only if they're feeling melee. Like, the Mag versus Kunkka has been happening. Kunkka and SD, they could combine up together, but then you'd have trouble getting the kills, and you kind of, if you're going to grab a Kunkka, you'd want to go aggressive. You're aggressive on your tri-lane. You'd want to. And at this point, that might be the one thing that's making Puppy take his time on this draft, because he's not quite sure. Like, Kunkka could come up, and then we see Kunkka, SD, Lina. Very, very strong, aggressive tri-lane that could run on the top lane. Lifestealer. Of course, he's great to escape from that kind of stuff. There's the Queen of Pain. So I think he feels like he's backed into a corner with that pickup after, like,
yeah.
He has to find the synergy, and he's not going to, like, rely on a Darkseer to do it.
Right, right, right. And, yeah, well, of course, with the Magnus, it's so hard to draft it against Clockwork in general. The fact that Cogs is just one-click spell that can set the entire positioning of the team fight and ruin the lives of many, many positional-based heroes. It's definitely expected that the Queen would come out here. I do expect Keita Gaming to pick up the Kunkka, as much as it might force them to do. I mean, there are a lot of fantastic things going with the Kunkka, and I'll be completely honest. Ever since the buffs to Ghost Ship has happened, it honestly doesn't matter whether you hit it or whether you whiff it, because if the bolt just happens, if it just occurs in the teamfight, it's going to do a lot of work. And by that, I mean against burst damage heroes like Queen, and instantaneous heroes like Darkseer,
mm-hmm.
You want to have those kind of instant survivability spells. You want to be able to stay alive and do that. And you know what? Dragon Knight is another one. The only problem with Dragon Knight is Queen of Pain does extremely, extremely well against DK in the first couple of levels. When DK starts getting his Bottle Curl up, the Queen even has a hard time against the Bottle Curl spam out of the Dragon Breath. But at the same time, Queen in general has a very high advantage. A very good advantage, pardon me, against a lot of melee heroes.
So,
and Dragon
Knight, you're actually filling DK for the middle lane?
Yeah, I am.
10 seconds remaining.
What are the options that you would think of?
Well, I'm wondering if it's DK up remaining. Against Darkseer on the bottom lane, and we still haven't seen the Lina SD combo. They're waiting until Na'Vi picked up their last tier so they could realize if the lanes can be aggressive enough or not. Like, you got Visage, Rubick, and Lifesteal now in that top lane. Difficult to go against, but even with a
gyrocopter,
Gyro, yeah.
Yeah, I think the Gyro has to be the last pick here. If they don't take Kunkka or Gyro, I'd be very surprised.
The problem they have, though, is that top lane. There's no way the Clockwork can go up against it right now. You got a Rubick and a Visage up there. Yeah, Weaver's going to be their final selection. They needed someone who's a lot more elusive. The Clockwork can go...
But would Weaver work, though? I mean, it's great in terms of the... Yeah, it's very elusive. It's a hard buck to catch. But against burst damage, once again, it just comes down to if you survive or not. And yeah, I see Maglev Gank Train. Yeah, his name is kind of hard to say. The Gank Train. I'm just going to call him the Gank Train.
I call him Maglev. It makes it a hell of a lot easier.
Really?
Yep.
Oh man, my tongue's going to twist every time I try to say that. But yeah, Maglev is picking up the Weaver. Are they going to go tri lane aggressive with that and put the safe lane Clockwork? I don't know. He's picked up a Stealth Shield already. It kind of looks like it's a setup. He's walking to the lane. It might just be... I have no idea what I'm talking about.
Everyone's running south. As far as their players go, CYSO is their mid-solo player. So he will be taking up that role. Maglev, if I...
I don't like that choice of the Stealth Shield against Queen, but go on.
You're not liking the DK like there in the mid?
Yeah, I'm not liking the Stealth Shield because I feel like if you just run up a bottle fast, that's pretty much your entire key to surviving in the lane. Queen does a ridiculous amount of right clicks regardless of whether you have a Stealth Shield or not, and most of DK's defensive capabilities come from his Dragon Blood, which gives him the extra armor to tank up. So I don't know. I feel like the Stealth Shield might just be a thorn in his side where he kind of just delays his bottle because of the 250 extra gold invested, but that's just me.
I'm loving that the Na'Vi guys are being so creative on the mini-map right now. Getting bored inside their own jungle as they're walking around. I've also actually taking more time to draw than he is to move at this point. And your lanes, okay, so what do we got? Let's run through them, and as they have started to settle down. Phlox will be the top lane as the Clockwork Goblin. Put CYSO into that middle lane as the DK. Stavstyle will be the SD on the bottom lane. He will be there supporting with Frigolite as the Lina. That puts our last one, Maglev, the bottom lane Weaver. And they are meant to be going up against Funnik, but Funnik, well, he'll realize the tri-lanes in the bottom lane defensive, so he'll sack the bottom lane and go into his own jungle. He has the Darkseer, Dendi into the middle lane as the Queen of Pain, and that leads a defense tri-lane as definitely expected. Havorth as the Lifestealer, puts Kuro as the Visage, and Puppy capping it off as the Rubick.
Now, this is the interesting part that I was wondering why. So we see Maglev here, he picked up the Geminate attack to double attack, and yeah, he's going to be farming up. But it looks more apparent that he's trying to push the lane. Why I was wondering about the Weaver pick is this, because when you have the Darkseer, yeah, Weaver is a very good counter in general. But at the same time, you have to consider the fact that we saw the other day, Toby, the example, the finest example of a free farming Weaver on the safe lane. It just does not have enough damage. It does not pay for your double supports just pulling the lane and watching you farm. A hero like Gyrocopter, a hero like Kunkka, they can do a lot more when the team fight comes. But there's no doubt in my mind that Weaver is definitely better early on, especially with the Shiguchi kicking in. He can do a lot of team fight wreaking and havoc.
Yeah.
Now, with him pushing the lane, and you know what? It's not even a push. But the interesting thing is, like, they're double pulling the creeps, so they're going to get their levels up. But the Shadow Demon Lina combo, it's going to be hard to find a kill on a Queen of Pain. Especially with the DK at mid. It becomes blatantly obvious when the DK is trying to walk up to land a stun or something. Mm-hmm. So yeah, I don't know. Like, I feel like a Gyrocopter would have been better than the Weaver, but nevertheless, if they can put it out at the mid game where they put up some sort of fights and perform that way, then I have no doubt in my mind that it can work. Yeah,
I kind of like the pickup, man, just for the fact that Na'Vi don't have enough controls over the Weaver. So if he does get a Lincoln Sphere up and running, Na'Vi won't be able to do anything about him. Like, they'll try their burst damage, they'll try and lock him down, but he's not going to be stopped as we just lose Frigolite from the game. Puppy being very, very nice. Puppy pausing for the team, we just lost a player.
Puppy pause, oh yeah, gosh.
It's a puppy pause for the greater good, man! He pauses for a good reason, reconnect him out back again, Frigolite can come back. But, like, okay, look at it this way. You're going to get two Sheep Sticks up, one possibly on the Darkseer, one possibly up on the Queen of Pain if she doesn't go an Orchid. And that's the only way they can control the Weaver. And in the meantime, DK walks around quite freely doing his card thing with Poison Dragon, and you've got a Clockwork Cog who's going to be, like, destroying everything in the fight. Shadow Demon Disruption can also buy time for that Weaver, and then coupling up if they need to. There can be that combination between the SD and the Lina on a hero like a Rubick or even the Visage himself, where they look for the control up on him. So you got all these different things together that, in my mind, synergize a hell of a lot better once the Weaver gets farmed. And Weaver is, in fact, adding pressure to that bottom tier 1 tower. He is, in fact, pushing it with the Gemini attack, as you were saying, but I look at this and say, okay, Keita Gaming, early game, they don't want to fight anything. Phlox Plox, pray get some levels. DK, hope he keeps up, find some levels too. And Weaver gets space, and that's their goal right now. He only gets Linkers and he gets Yasha, and then they'll be happy to fight. Until that point, these supports are going to work over time to either get their levels from pulling and to keep up with the Darkseer who's inside the jungle, or to add some pressure to this middle lane. Push Dendi off this lane. It's already 10 for 1 up against 11 for 10. Wow, that's a lot of denies for Dendi.
Yeah, it's just the Queen of Pain versus a melee hero factor. There's really no stopping it. And of course, when you factor in Dendi being Dendi, then that's just the Dendi lane.
Kuro's going to have some fun with Phlox Plox, and Stevstar's coming to the top lane. He realizes there's going to be some kind of support right now. He's going to disrupt up on Kuro, Catcher as well. Cog's going to be a possibility, but Puppy, nice lift time. Phlox Plox, you can just see him looking to battery assault that one down or pop off the Cogs and hold him there in range of the tower. Even with the creep wave there, it would have forced Na'Vi to initiate, which they wouldn't have wanted to do at that point.
Right, right. And the rotation coming out of the Shadow Demon is very, very brilliant, I gotta say. Giving the entire solo EXP to Lina is going to allow the Lina to have a lot more EXP alone. But, you know, it just goes to show a different way of playing this combination. Because most of the time when you see Lina plus Shadow Demon, you expect aggression. Aggression, aggression, aggression. Smoke ganks, get kills early, get levels that way. But if you just use the Shadow Demon as a protector of sorts, where the clockwork, you know, he's level 3 in 4 minutes, he's doing pretty well for himself against the Trilane. And then consider the fact that the Shadow Demon also getting level 3 while giving the solo EXP to Lina, who's double pulling again. This is really just brilliant, solid plays coming out of that team. And I gotta say, as far as I'm concerned, this is my first game watching them, and I'm impressed.
Yeah, I was telling you, man, throughout the games of the defense for Keita, they've really been playing solid Dota, their strats look right, and their execution. Like, sometimes you can have amazing strats, but you don't execute it right, but they're doing it nicely. Like, simple things like an SD rotating up, as you're saying, Lina finding her levels. They know when they want to hit, they know their timing for it. DK, the pick in the middle lane up against the Queen of Pain, as you said, like, it's never a fantastic thing to have happened, but then you see this
well
kind of
played.
Thing happen, and Dendi, he copped a big hit from the Dragon Tail and the double damage that was there. COASO has a good time in the middle lane, but Dendi, he wants to be aggressive. He wants to make sure this DK fears him. It's a mental game for him in this middle lane, not just a physical battle.
Right.
Yeah, but I'm very happy with Keita's gaming performance so far. They've really been a good team. I'm looking forward to seeing how much they really get pressured, though. Like, when Na'Vi say, okay, we're finished farming, we're going to come out.
Did you see that? Sorry for cutting you off there. He baited the scream of pain out of Dendi, because he's put Dendi, scared Dendi a little. It was really nice.
I didn't actually see that, man. That's TP supports come middle lane. You want the aggression? They're going to give this a shot with Dragon Tail, Lightstrike Array follow-up, maybe? And then...
bad timing.
They got revealed. They got revealed. Yeah, Dendi just moved back a little bit. DK doesn't really have mana to go for this. But with the presence of SD now here in the middle lane, Dendi knows he has to stay in range of his own tower. And which means he can't control the regeneration rune, which is being saved, and DK is going to get this.
Wow, that's a pretty big deal, because now that he's in Dragon form, he can constantly harass a little bit. Well, he should be a little bit careful. If Dendi has enough mana and he knows that, what he doesn't know is that Dendi doesn't have Sonic Wave, but at level 6 Queen of Pain, you have to kind of assume that he does.
Mm-hmm.
Which is why he popped the regen, and he's going in for... No, Puppy's rotation is going to save him. Dendi might have actually died there if Shadow Demon was able to poison once with the Dragon Breath level 3.
Mm-hmm.
So, once again, supports. Just good rotations coming out of both teams on supports. What's so funny?
Just watching a Vos get bumped twice by Cogs on the top lane and pushes him even in range of the tier 1 tower to cop a hit from that. It's amazing what a hero who's 3 levels below you can do to you when he burns off the health and the mana. But I don't know if you also noticed too, the Funnik rotated down towards the bottom lane and the build up on Weaver. He went Phase Boots Weaver. And this is actually not the first time we've seen Maglev do this. He's done this previously. CYSO, this could be first blood in the middle lane. Denny, he wants to scream, but he got stunned up with that Dragon Tail, and he couldn't follow through straight away. Yeah, but this isn't the first time he's done this. It's such a high maneuverability hero, because even when he's out of the Shikuchi, he still moves very, very fast, and as far as last hitting and harassment goes with a gem attack, it's this little bit of like extra damage, which you would never really expect at the very, very start. But notice also his next item, a Helm of Iron Wills coming up from him.
Oh my gosh, is this going to be like a revolutionary arm that Weaver built? It just might be. I'm in high anticipation for this one. My usual qualms with... Well, that thought, top lane aggression.
Yeah, this should be first blood. Phloxbox is going to try and pop off the cogs, but still, a Vorse too close. Disruption doesn't come there in time. And Stevstyle, he's got support coming in. He's trying to kill off a Vorse. This would be worth it if they can kill off a Vorse, but the Lion Strike Array, it stops Puppy for the moment. And Weaver, he did come in. He got the kill at the end of the day. Now they move over towards Puppy. It's going to be a 2-for-2 trade, but it's a Vorse and Puppy both going down. And meanwhile, East Kuro's being chased by a melee creep. The Weaver waves on him, and CYSO, Denny's trying to help him off. There goes the Dragon Form, so he got the range attack. The poison tick over, it won't send him critical. He'll keep him at one life point the entire time. And Dendi will, Dendi goes back to the middle lane. Kuro was able to escape and keep it as a 2-2 trade.
Lot of rotations coming out from both teams. Oh! Hold that thought, Dendi getting harassed up a little bit in the mid lane.
There's no follow-up here. In fact, Na'Vi have a better chance of getting a kill because of the Familiars who get a double stun. But Dendi doesn't have damage to follow up. The bottle's still back at base, and now it's being brought out.
Meanwhile, Phoenix having the time of his life down here, saw the opportunity of all the rotations and decides to skip the creep wave. With the rotation of the Weaver, is he gonna die?
Disruption, it's gonna cancel off a lot of it, but in comes Lifestealer. Look at that damage of the Iron Shell, plus a Vorse Reichling. Maglev, he's forced to time-lapse out this damage, but he wants to go on Funnic, and at the same time, there's a Laguna Blade! It just gave him vision to do so. Puppy lets off a Fade Bolt, and Luna, Galena, yeah, no, she doesn't. She gets killed at the end of that one. Funnic got the kill because the Iron Shell was still on a Vorse. Without that extra damage, they wouldn't have been able to get the trade-off then. But we go 3-4 now on the board.
Man, normally these amount of kills in the early game, especially without smoke rotations, is kind of just like misplays here and there. But this game, for some reason, Toby, it seems like both teams are actually just playing really well. And I don't know why. Maybe it's because, like, for example, you know, you saw Kuroki and Puppy dive at the top lane, you know, between the tier 1 and tier 2, right? And Kuroki was able to actually get out of that, which was the most impressive thing for me. And then at the bottom lane, Havost, he actually rotated in as the hard carry, and I see him do this with Lifesteal all the time. He loves to fight. This guy is like, he's a hard carry player that always wants to get aggressive, always wants to get kills, and he does it. And you know
he's
what?
He's gonna
what
try
better
and find one. Open wound, sting, scream. Ulti's not there for Queen of Pain again. Short of the mana by about 40 or so. So the DK picked up, throwing down, in comes the Weaver, Maglev, he runs up and kills off Kuro, there goes Laguna Blade, kills off a Vorse, now they move over towards Dendi, who's forced back a long, long way, and Maglev, he'll dive this the entire way, he's got 7-1 charges, doesn't care about the damage that Dendi will do, it's a double kill for Maglev, and he really is riding that gank train.
Keita Gaming, man. This is really, really impressive. That's all I can say. They're playing a really, really good game. The Clockwork just hit level 6. This is going to be really, really good for them soon too, because as soon as Cogs as well as Hook comes into these team fights, the DK as well as the Weaver won't lose time doing the DPS because they can just sit there and just lock down on the targets. Mm-hmm. Meanwhile, Funnic was able to finish a mech in the midst of all this.
Yeah,
wow.
He's been having a good time on bottom lane. He was still creep skipping through all of that. And remember, even if he died in bottom lane, there was still the follow-up. Oh, nice little pick-up by Stevstyle. He just stole one of the familiars of Kuro. So Kuro will resummon already. But yeah, Funnic has had a presence on this bottom lane. It's held him out a little bit, and now Phlox throws the rocket, realizes Funnic's down low. He's got an ulti a surge target. This is not an easy thing to do. He's trying to come in close. Battery assault. Now Funnic no longer surge. There goes a lockdown. Hold him inside the cogs. Can't do it. No mana available. He's trying to bottle up, and now he's got enough for the cogs. Funnic pops off his... He's trying to back him out of the cogs. There we go. Kuro needs a little bit more space. The Gemini attack. 7 HP he goes down to.
Oh, man. Radiant's bottom tower is Funnic making plays.
Rocket.
But, oh, the rocket.
It go. He thought he was going to go west. Funnic evaded it.
Wow.
He was actually hanging in the trees over on the right side.
Toby, it's the arm that built. It's the arm that Weaver built. It's my first time seeing this. Let's see how it goes.
I am interested to see just how effective this can be. So he's using the armlet and then combines it with time lapse. But he doesn't have a lot of life points because he went phase boots. There's not a lot of life points for him to play around with. And that's why I'm interested to see what's also going to happen. If he wanted to go a Lincoln Sphere, he can't do that anymore. In fact, he's almost got to rush up a heart just so he's able to support the life points required to use an armlet.
Yeah, it's so interesting because armlet always has to have synergy with some sort of lifesteal or massive regeneration to combat the loss of HP.
Mm-hmm.
It's going to be very interesting. Like, I have no idea what his item build is going to be from this point on.
It's going to be hard, man. It's either going to be hard. Vanguard and Hood could also work for him.
Oh, I don't know about Vanguard and Hood. I feel like that's just going to lose a lot of efficiency as it goes on because he needs to be the main DPSer in these fights. TK going to the mid lane is fantastic. Most of the time, they'll go for a Shadow Blade or a BKB and they'll lose some damage. So, I think he needs to go something other than Vanguard or Hood. Heart is fine because it'll transition. It's a big item. But yeah, needless to say, I have no idea what he's going to go for. The interesting thing, now that I understand it, is the phase boots. Like, you know when they were ganking off Funnik? If he had treads, he would have been able to get the kill because he would have attacked faster and just gotten more right clicks in. Mm-hmm. Of course, it would have been at the cost of 24 damage. But now I see why the phase boots, man. It's because Armlet gives 25 attack speed, and then, yeah, with the activation total, it gives you 25 attack speed. So the extra damage buff is good, which is kind of similar to the Lone Druid, right? He's essentially playing this as a bear. You get the phase boots and armlet, you have a fair share of damage as well as attack speed, and you rock on, basically.
Well, he's about to have to rock in the middle lane. Na'Vi, they're really grouping up, but the breathe fire of DK slows down this creep wave so much, but they've got a catapult with it. So it kind of looks like Na'Vi want to push it out, but Shadow Poison takes care of the wave from range anyway. And they're moving down, looking for a kill. Clockwork's the closest one. Funnik, he tried to vac him, but Clockwork just high enough up the hill. And at the same time, Weaver, he's got so much space in the bottom lane. Havors is finding his space, but he's doing it inside the jungle. He's almost finished up his armlet. And I say almost, because he hasn't. Like, his armlet's going to come up at 1430, and he sacrificed himself so he can pick up a hand of Midas. Of course, this has made him still, actually not the highest net worth hero on the map. I thought it would have because he's running the hand of Midas and he's looking as a higher level right now, but Weaver is in fact still the highest net worth on the map. Only by 100 gold, but that's him, highest net worth, up against a hand of Midas.
Havorst
now just pins him at the post. He just used the next challenge of the hand of Midas. And he's going to get all that farm on the top lane, which Maglev finds himself wasting time being up here now.
Well, speaking of wasting time, though, that's just the thing. Like, he's 0-2, this guy. And even without the Midas, he would have a higher CS right now. And all I can say is this is both teams, man. I don't know, Toby. This is some impressive Dota coming out. We're not so high in kills, but just the efficiency and the rotation.
You're going to get him in a moment, man. Familiar, one drop, second drop, it's Puppy. He tried to shooky himself. Yeah, he does. He picks up Maglev, throws him back. Where's that sentry ward from them? Or is just fade time, Steph style. Taking a lot of damage from those familiars when they came back up again. Soul Assumption kills him off. And the Goonblade, not enough to kill off Kuro. He's got himself another nuke, which he can't throw off in time. And there's the gem actually stolen. Or was it? Where'd the gem go? You find it, man. Flockbox on the run. Puppy's right behind him, a pickup, a throwback down again. I think it was actually denied up there by the Weaver before he time-lapsed and Phlox-Pox. Havorst will take his life again with these familiar stuns. Chain 1, chain 2, keeps with the stuns going down. And they'll go deeper.
Oh,
blink to infest
so
damage. It was the only way they can get to Lina in time, and he didn't want to take any chances. Hurls out the ultimate and gets the kill. The tower's gone, the tier 1 on the top lane, the tier 2 tower's about to follow. Even with DK doing the damage down the middle lane. He really needs to be there. And yeah, the gem was in fact denied off by the Weaver.
Man, plays. What can I say? Just really, really good fight for Na'Vi overall. But as you said, the DK wasn't there. We have to keep in mind when the DK comes in, he's going to come in with a Shadow Blade most likely. He's so close to it, he's going to get the Invis Rune, probably farm up bottom lane as a result. And when he has that Shadow Blade, man, Dendi can no longer do some of the things he's been doing. He's rushing for the BKB. Dendi knows, even though he's doing so well in terms of kills, even though he was able to make those plays, mm-hmm. he knows that one stun is going to be able to kill him, especially with Clockwork, Shadow Demon, Lina. Oh my gosh, Lina, DK, he knows, like, he cannot fight spells on that hero, it's too squishy. So the BKB will be the first item of choice. And with the BKB, as well as all the Funic spells, you know, he's got Mana Boots up on top of the Mechanism now. And Havos, he picked up the Armlet too, he didn't have it last fight, he almost had all the pieces flying out to him. Mm-hmm. So with that, you know, Navi,
Puppy. They're gonna have a better team fight. Shikuchi, may have to pick up and throw back Stev Style. Vac brings him in closer. Nice, then the Grave Chill and the Nuke. What a disruption timing. That basically saved his life then, but Familiar drops one, drops a secondary. Nice line strike array. Holds a Vorst out. He got surged up. He's still looking for blood. He's gonna find Phlox Blocks. You have to rage up to take this kill, but look at the amount of damage. He just turns on the armor, turns on the pain. CYSO coming with an Invis rune, looking for Funic. A Vorst taking too much damage, couldn't infest out. Denny comes in, he lets up the scream, he's already got one. The Sting on Frigolee, they've got to turn around and try and fight within this Darkseer wall. Time-lapse keeps Maglev alive, and he wants Kuro. Kuro's got a nuke, and now they see the vision. The Sentry Ward comes down, so they finally bring down the DK. Weaver Ball back so he can be part of this fight. But Na'Vi stand their ground on top of the Tier 1 tower. They lost a Vorst for it, but they're happy with it as well.
Na'Vi,
Now you see how much damage is done. He's going to be pulled back. Maglev, the Suns couldn't go. Shikuchi, 1 second, he's picked up, throwing down Scream. They get the kill. That was a buyback death on the Weaver. I don't think we can talk about his next item because it's about another 10 minutes away with that buyback and then into death.
Yeah, he time-lapsed into that fight. And needless to say, it didn't come off cooldown enough. Keita Gaming, they lost a lot there. I think just by the numbers, it tells from 7 to 8 to 8 to 13, they lost 5 kills. Now, Navi's going to look to take Roche. When Hovos rotates in, is he going to even rotate in? He's just going to go farm the bottom without rotating into the Aegis.
He doesn't need to be there.
Yeah.
At the end of the day, I think they're more concerned about Dendi than anybody else. So they'll give him the Aegis. The funny thing is, he didn't even use his BKB. I don't think he actually had his BKB flown out to him by the time that fight happened in the middle.
Right.
And they're going to give it, yeah. Dendi's the one in close. He takes the Aegis, the Immortal. And they're on the run out. Vorst didn't need to come in. He finds levels. He finds farm. He finds 3k gold on that bottom lane.
Oh,
after
dear.
Fight.
That is really, really scary, Toby. What's his next item going to be? Is it going to be the AC or the Deso or even the Orchids coming out? Or the Lifestealer against the Weaver.
I'm feeling Deso to get through the DK, man. I'm really feeling Deso. Because the side device is going to be there from the Queen of Pain. Denny's making it very, very obvious that's what he's building into. It could also be a Yule Scepter, but more than likely Scythe device. And then you got coming out from the Darkseer, another Scythe device. They don't need any more disables coming from a Vorst. They either need pure damage or life points. That's the way it's got to look at. That's why I think it's going to be a Desolator coming from him.
Uh-oh, we got the DK situated in a very funky spot, going to be returning two base away from that. And Maglev, in a similar scenario, where he has to go actually towards the Dire base just to escape. Oh, he's taking the creeps.
Smoke movement time for Keita. They're on the run. For some reason, the troll started to attack him. Oh, wow, that actually could have indicated the fact there was a sentry ward right over the top of it. And now it is Maglev on the run. From Havost.
Oh, Keita Gaming used to be out of Tangles. Uh-huh. OT, I remember them. Yeah, I remember those guys.
They've been around for a while, man.
Mm-hmm.
Their roster, I believe, has slightly changed, though. It has slightly changed. It'll be the reason why this team... It's one of those things with the Dota 2 scene where... Well, in all scenes, really, where teams change. They can change branding, and then it takes about a month before everyone kind of like realizes who the hell they are. And they say, yeah, this team's actually good. Like, I know most people, when they check out a match ticker, they look for the name. They don't look, like, the name of the team is their indicator to see, is this team versus this team going to be a good game? And then they say, yeah, it is. You don't go, is S4 playing tonight? Yeah, he is. Well, you do now, but you would not before. You would not before. No, he's been such a... Oh, wow, Puppy. What did he steal? He stole Poison. He wanted Disruption. He's going to pick up there on the Clockwork, throwing him down. Actually, stunning up on the...
Oh,
Dandy! A huge ultimate from him. Clockwork and SD just popped. Lina was lucky enough to TP out to safety. And Maglev, he was also lucky enough not to take the full damage from that.
You know, you use S4 as an example of whether the good game is going to happen, but you know, I think we've been forgetting about the main face of Dota, known as Navi Dendi. This guy, I'll tell you, every single team fight.
See why SO. He's having a crack at Funic. Come on, Funic, fight like a man. Chase down that DK.
With the Shadow Blade. Yeah, I don't think anything's gonna happen. Good mention on Funic though. He's almost got a sheepstick.
Uh huh.
Wow.
He's got a lot of farm, man. That's what I was saying before. Like the sheepsticks are already coming up the way for Navi. Dendi's sitting there at 3,300 gold. And he's got a Void Stone, so you take that into account. We're looking, what's that, 1,500 or so away from his Scythe of Vice?
Yeah, he's relatively close. Probably about, almost about 1,500. And popping the regen rune, he's going to be able to get the next piece set up. And looks like about 1,100 now that he sold his Magic Stick. The interesting thing coming out of Keita is that the Dragon Knight, he's still here with Shadow Blade. And, oh, you know what? He's actually camping Funic.
Yeah.
Wow. Is this going to turn out to be something?
No.
No. Yeah, no.
No, when Puppy's there, man. And Puppy, I think he's looking to steal a dragon form. Even if he takes dual breath, that's still fine for him. There's a backup. He throws down the sentry. He sees him run up high. And they can block him in here. Secondary sentry. They'll see him. And telekinesis got to go. Picks him up.
Oh, so
only
close.
Just in time. And this will be the death of the DK. He pops his stick charges for this one as well. So he can live one last breathe fire. Familiar's also on the run. Kuro was looking to solo up the Armlet Weaver.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, with all this fantastic micro, with the arm that...
Havorst? Sorry, Havorst? Sorry. Check his gold, man. Why has he bought nothing?
He's trolling. It's typical Havorst. He's gonna get some silly item. Like maybe like a bash, assault. No, not assault.
He just buys an astray abyssal.
Yeah, that's right. He might just go for that. Either that or he's trolling. This guy is always trolling.
He buys a Radiance 23 minutes in. Okay, there's the Basher. Yeah, he's gonna go for his Abyssal Blade. The courier's already on the way to the shop. So that'll explain where his cash is gonna go. He's 100 gold away from his Abyssal as well. Which he's now gonna take if he wants to infest it, but he doesn't need to. He should be saving that for the initiation. And with his Centaur, if the Iron Shell stops taking the last hit, he would be fine. But the Iron Shell took the last hit. Three arrows from Keita are grouping up on the bottom lane. Havorst now has his full Abyssal. Flying out in the courier. Movement speed still on cooldown for it though, so it's going to take some time before it's going to get there. But this is a tier 2 for a tier 2 trade. Maglev is in fact using that armlet to push out, and he's going to go into a Desolator. It could be his BKB, because he went Mithrilheimer first. If he was going to go BKB, I would have expected the Ogre Club to help offset the armlet.
Yeah, this is the problem with Weaver once again. You buy an item like BKB on Weaver, because like in this game, I'll tell you, against two sheepsticks and all those spells, you have to. I know we mentioned about like the semi-lack of lockdown, but that's going to be solved very easily with Dendi rotating in. Now, he's going to do a little bit of harassment. No, they're both just playing mind games with each other.
He's trying to bait out the Shikuchi.
Yeah, that's right. And Havorst picks up another kill. Where was that?
It was
solo kill.
It was. If you're looking at my position right now, right here next to the harder camp on the middle lane of the Radiant side.
See, after the Lina dies, I gotta ask what Lina's doing there. But generally speaking, what was Havorst doing there?
That would be a better question, man.
I don't know, man.
Seriously, there's a hex on top lane. Maglev, in comes Puppy. Telekinesis hold. He can't even get his time lapse off. Didn't have the armor activated when he got picked up as well. And now Na'Vi with the Weaver on the sideline. They're already pushing on the tier 3 tower. If Weaver had the money for a buyback, he would probably be using it, but he does not. And Havorst dies for more, but the Colts now get popped off. They just want the tower. Purge is being used on the life sealer, but he's inside of Rage. So he just walks himself away. He's still got the armor and Abyssal. He does so much damage for anyone who comes in close. So when he comes, open wounds up again, blink in by Puppy, pick up and throw down. There's nasty disruption, Funic, back in, doesn't actually combine it up with a wall. It's almost like it's on cooldown, that's why he can't do it, but Havorst pops out of the infest, gets a double kill with the AoE damage, then into that open wounds on CYSO, Fable damage, Familiar's helping out, Soul Assumption from Kuro will take the kill. And they'll have a little bit of time to, well actually no, they go actually into the well to take out the SD. And now they'll come back for the tier 3 tower. Keita Gaming, they had such a strong start to this game, it's almost sad to see this happen.
Man, Toby, I gotta tell you, it really is. It's not so much a disappointment. I'm just disappointed that they couldn't put out a better performance, because I feel like, as you said, with the early game setup, they had all the pieces of the puzzle ready to complete it. They couldn't complete it, and I don't know, man. Like, for me, it's the Weaver pick. That hero, it just baits the hero into situations where you think you can survive by Suguchi, where you think you can survive by skill difference and extra knowledge. It doesn't work against experienced teams, because as we know, Weaver has two solutions. You either disable the crap out of him, or you burst him down 100-0 him before he can react. And needless to say, in this game, Toby, every single time he's died, he just got 100-0. Like, there's just no questions about it. And if I just, part of me just feels, if this was a safe lane hard carry that was abusing the tri lane support, if it was abusing the farm to maximize efficiency so that long as the game progresses, it might have done a lot more work.
Mm-hmm. It didn't at the end of the day, man, and that means Na'Vi take the first game in this two-game series. And we will be going on to our next game here. Of course, remember, this won't be all the games for tonight. We'll be having the last game of this series. Then Na'Vi will play another two-game series up against Team Empire. So Na'Vi will play up against their old comrade, Light of Heaven. And then into our last game of the night, where Keita Gaming will play up against Team Empire. All the games coming from the Defense Season 4 tonight, guys. So stay tuned. We got more coming your way. We'll be back.
I said good day, sir!